Let me introduce you, Maurizio Farotti from, wow, you have a few certifications. I think it's the University Paris-Saclay, the main one, or?
Yes.
Okay. So please, you're going to start.
Okay, so hello, and I would like to thank the organizer for the invitation. And today I would like to present some model that emerges in some strong Capri limit. And this model has some kind of peculiar transform properties, so I think it could be interesting for this conference. So the setting I'm considering is what is now known as quench dynamics, which essentially means that we study the time evolution after we prepare the initial state in some physical relevant state, which can be a ground state or thermal state. And then the idea is to suddenly change some global parameter, like a magnetic field or a coupling constant. And the systems that are generally considered are many-body. So the typical example are spin lattice systems or quantum field theories. Here I'm focusing on spin lattice systems. So in particular, it means that the local inverse space is finite dimensional, and the total dimension scales exponentially with the volume of the system. Now, in this kind of lattice model, there is a basic theorem of quantum mechanics that tells us that there is no relaxation. And the reason is that the energy eigenvalues are discrete. So this means that if you wait sufficiently long time, your state will be close to your original state, okay, as you wish. Now, there are ways of circumventing this theorem. And one possibility is to consider relaxation on average, which means that you imagine to consider the state after a long time, random time t, and then you wonder what is the expectation value of some observable. And the answer is that there is a high probability that it will be close to a particular value that one calls the stationary expectation value of the observable. And can be described in some effective way, like diagonal ensembles or thermal ensembles. Another possibility, that is the one that I'm considering today, is to go to the thermodynamic limit, because then one can go against an hypothesis a basic assumption of the theorem, which is that the eigenvalues are discrete. This is because in the thermodynamic limit, the level spacing, the eigenspace becomes dense in the energy. So this means that it's possible to see some relaxation properties. And in other words, if you study the expectation value of some observable, it will relax to some value. And it is generally believed that in general system, you can describe this stationary value by means of thermal ensemble, Gibbs ensemble. So you just need one parameter. And instead, if you consider more symmetric systems like integrable, then you have to consider more complicated statistical ensemble. And they have been called, in this case, generalized Gibbs ensemble. I think first by Marcos Rigol. So the okay, this is about relaxation, so about the large time behavior. But very often, what happens when one studies system is that these observers seem to relax at shorter times, intermediate times, to values which are not consistent with this thermalization or relaxation to Gibbs ensemble. So, I give you just a few examples. One example is the so-called pre-thermalization. And this happens when the system under investigation is close to being integrable, despite being generic. In other words, this means that there are not really exact conservation laws, but there are operators which are quasi-conserved. So what one observes is that there are a very long time scale at which the observers seem to be stationary, but they relax to the wrong expectation value. And in order to see the real thermalization, one has to wait a very long time, okay, an exponentially large time. So this was known in a generic system, but actually, essentially, the same situation happens also in integrable systems, which are by definition more symmetric than generic systems. The difference now is that instead of being close to an integrability point with more conservation laws, one should be close to some supersymmetric point. So one should have even more conservation laws than in an integral system. So this means that you should have even more conservation laws than the one you need to characterize a complete set of eigenstates of the model. And in the past, I studied two simple possibilities. One was the weak coupling limit in quantum XY model, because in the when there is no magnetic field, this model becomes indeed non-abelian integral, super integral. And then because of this, when the magnetic field is small, one realized that there is this intermediate time dynamics, which is not described by a GG, a conventional GG. But okay, now I'm more interested in the other example, which is this one. And is the strong coupling limit of the XXZ Heisenberg model, which is an interacting model, and it's as we will see in a moment, I will show the Hamiltonian, is a translation invariant model. And what one finds, which is kind of unexpected, for example, when you consider this large strong coupling limit in the anisotropy, is that the translation invariant is not restored. So you have a very long, sometimes you have a very long time window where observables. Where the observable is still, the expectation value depends on whether the site is even or odd, okay? And so, okay, it could be interesting to understand how can we capture this kind of dynamics in an effective way. So we have to understand how to treat this model in this strong coupling limit. And okay, these are just some basic observations of strong coupling limits that when you have a Hamiltonian written like in this case, like H0 plus some perturbation, H1, and let's assume this perturbation is very large, so more than a perturbation is kind of is the opposite. So it's important to understand that when k kappa here goes to zero, it doesn't mean that we can neglect H0, but actually H0 is very important in the time evolution. Indeed, what happens, especially in spin chains, is that the part of the time evolution related to this HI is kind of trivial. Generally, it's like a rotation or in some space or something like that. Instead, the slow dynamics is driven by something related to H0. And so one question is, how can we capture these dynamics? And then, okay, what we did is inspired by an old work by McDonald collaborator 30 years ago that we were working on the Hubbard model, is that it seems to be possible in kind of generic spin chains to represent quantum time evolution in the following way. So one can attach some part of the time evolution operator to the operator, and in such a way that the operator time evolves periodically, and the period is proportional to this parameter kappa. Instead, the state time evolves with an effective Hamiltonian, which is time independent, okay? And in case of the Hamiltonian that can be written in this form, which, okay, it could appear as kind of weird, but it's very general. You have this kind of expansion in almost every model that you can imagine, spin chain. And the only difference that this number Q changes. But in a moment when you write in this form, then it's possible to compute this effective Hamiltonian order by order, okay, in a perturbative way. Here, just to give an example, I show you the result for Q equal 2. And these are the first order of the expansion, which can be written in terms of this operator, essentially that you identify in the Hamiltonian. And for Q equal 2 means, for example, this is a possible model. It's the easing model in transverse longitudinal field, where you identify HF equal to the practical DXX model, and then these two operator F1 and F2. Okay, so with this machinery, the idea is that we can somehow replace our original Hamiltonian with this effective Hamiltonian when we take this kind of strong coupling limit. And we would like to apply this to my favorite model now, which is the XXZ spumular chain that I mentioned before. This is the Hamiltonian. So what I was saying before, the anisotropy is related to this parameter, delta. So the idea is to see what happens when you increase delta, okay? If you increase delta and you apply this kind of folded picture, then you find that there is an emergent symmetry generated by this operator, yeah? You want symmetry, and then you end up with this effective Hamiltonian. Okay, this is a four, this is a Hamiltonian with a range 4. So it's not if you like us prefer to work with a shorter range Hamiltonian, it's more convenient to map it to something different. So, and in particular, we realized that there is a duality transformation, which is very similar to the easing one that map this order into order operators, which brings this Hamiltonian in this form, which now is only range tree. Okay, and we call this dual folded excessive model. I mentioned that this Hamiltonian is correspond to a special point of the Barrier model, which is was studied 30 years ago. In its general form, is an integrable model and solved by nested variances. So it's kind of a complicated model. But this is a very special symmetric point of the model. And so let's see what is Hamiltonian, what this Hamiltonian does. So the action on a state which is written in terms of spin in the z direction is very simple. So simply this Hamiltonian moves a spin up when it's possible. And the constraint is that there should be two spin down close to the spin up. Okay. It is convenient to parameterize this kind of a simple action introducing two species of particles. I will call this a particle plus, and with this kind of a triangle with this particular orientation. And this triangle means that there is a spin up on an even position. Instead, if the spin up is in an odd position, I use this other representation. I call this minus. Why I'm doing this? Because now if you, let's assume that we have just an initial state like this, of this form, this the sequence of spins. And then let's see what happens when I apply the Hamiltonian. So this spin could move here. Oh, sorry, here. And so this means that this plus particle move here, or otherwise could move on the other side, and this is what happens. Otherwise, this spin could move here, okay? Or no, it can move on the other side. The spin analogy could move there, but it can't move on the other side. This spin can move here, but it can move on the other side, and so on, okay? So this means that there are just two species. So this Hamiltonian describes two species of freely moving impenetrable particles, okay? And in particular, we can, from here, we can immediately realize that the cyclic sequence of species is conserved by the Hamiltonian. And this is an emergent symmetry, because if you consider the original model, the excessive model is not, this doesn't happen, okay? So, well, from this picture, we can also immediately identify non-interacting sectors of the model. And this corresponds to when in the state there are only particles of a single species. Indeed, one can easily realize that the time evolution is equivalent to the time evolution of a hopping Hamiltonian, the excess Hamiltonian, which is not interacting, is known. So the question is, where is interaction? There is interaction still in this limit, because this limit of large theta is usually called easing limit, neglecting maybe that there is a part of the Hamiltonian which is interacting. So the question is there really interaction or not? Now, okay, well, let's compare. Clearly, we need to consider two species of particles because we know that with a single species is not interacting. Now we see that in this configuration, nothing changes with respect to before. Now, if I consider a particle plus in this configuration, it can move here, it can move there, nothing. It's different from the non-interacting case. Something starts being different if I put this kind of sequence, because this, the possibility to move the particle in the same microsite is possible only if I have two species of particle. And that is where is interaction. And indeed, one can, this is manifest in the scattering matrix, which is non-trivial only if there is a particle minus before a particle plus. When I say trivial, I mean, trivial means that it's just a fermionic, free fermion scattering matrix, which is a minus one, that's like minus one. Otherwise, as you can see from here, it means that instead of being minus one, it becomes a phase. Okay. Nevertheless, this is probably one of the simplest integrable models that you can imagine. And you can solve it by coordinate by the ansatz. So what you have to do essentially you have to fix the configuration of particles, which is an invariant. Then you can parameterize the eigenstate by set of momenta or rapidities. And the eigenstate are superposition of plane waves. Okay. And the only subtlety here is that the position of the particle is not given by the site, but by the macro site, because each particle here is associated to two spins, okay? Okay, then, the model is so simple that I can even easily exhibit the solution to the Betti equations, which is not common, I would say. In particular, if you denote by M the number of minus particles followed by plus, then you have these are the equation that describe stationary state. The question such that the that should be satisfied by the stationary state parameterized by these momental rapidities. Okay. Now, okay, the details are not important. The kind of surprising part is that I can write down a solution to this equation. And you see, these are our unknown, the momenta. They can be expressed in terms of quantum numbers, J, like in non-interacting case. In the non-interacting case, the quantum numbers are just integer, okay? Here, what you have is that they are not really integer. They are just shifted integer because they are rational number. And that is where interaction is, okay? So this is a kind of very simple integrable systems. So essentially here I'm representing these quantum numbers. So this could be a representation of a stationary state where these are the quantum number present in the state. Is it customary to call momenta of the particles, the one associated with quantum numbers present in the state, and holes, the one that are not present? Okay, why I'm telling you this? Because when you go into the thermodynamic limit, you change the representation, and instead of expressing everything in terms of rapidities, you express everything in terms of the density of rapidities in the corresponding space. So with this, I mean, for example, that when you have sum over the rapidities of a function, you in the thermodynamic limit, you replace the sum by an integral, and you define the root density as the weight of this integral. Okay. And now if you use the scattering matrix, the property of the system, you can write almost immediately an equation that relates the density of particles with the density of all, okay, which we could call first thermodynamic Betanzas equation. This is very general, nothing new. And then, okay, generally this is not enough to characterize our macro states, because we have to establish still a relation between the root density and the state itself. And this is usually done by minimizing the free energy, if one is interested in thermal states or generalized Gibbs ensemble. But in homogeneous situations like the one that I'm more interested in, you have to replace this kind of second step, which is a standard one, with what is now known as generalized hydrodynamic equation. So what do I mean with this? So, in an integral model, you have infinitely many conservation laws. Okay, and in particular, what happens in integral system that you can easily, you can express the expectation value in a simple form. Okay, this is a very old result, so that the expectation value of the charges are written like a sum of function of the rapidities. This is a very new result, okay, and it's about the expectation value of the currents. But now, nevertheless, okay, now it's possible to express both of them in terms of the rapidities. And then it becomes easy to take the thermodynamic limit. So here I already told you that we have to replace sums with integrals. We can do the same here. And what we find that the current now is written as of the integral of rho times V times Q, where Q depends on the conservation laws that you are considering. Okay, these are just expressions that they can be derived. In the simple model that I'm considering, this function associated with the charges are very simple, are just cosine and sine. Okay. So, this means that if you have the expectation value of charges and expectation value of currents, you can write a continuity equation that you have to satisfy charge by charge. Now, since every charge should satisfy this equation and Q are a complete set, a complete basis in L2, then this means also the integral should satisfy this equation. And this is more or less what is called the generalized hydrodynamic equation. Okay, in our case, there is something more. And this is related to the fact that if we impose that also the density of all excitation should satisfy the same equation, then we have an additional equation, which is an equation for this auxiliary parameter, m over n, which appears in this effective velocity, okay? And then, okay, this is just a special example of hydrodynamic equation that have been used recently for the last years to characterize the scaling limit in the presence of inhomogeneities. So what happens in particular in our model? So, this is a very simple example when we consider the junction of two thermal states and we start the transport, so the energy transport. And here I'm plotting the energy as a function of the position at different times. So what you can see is that the larger is the time and the more this point move to a function of the ratio x over t. Okay, so it becomes a function of x over t. And you can see here that in the numerical data, in agreement with this with our GHT prediction. Now, what is peculiar of the model is okay, this happens in every integrable systems, and generally you find some smooth curves here. What is peculiar of the model is that you have discontinuities, and but you don't have discontinuities on kind of special operators, energy or particular conservation laws. You have a discontinuity for any local observables. Okay, this is related to the fact that we have this parameter m over n, which satisfy a special equation. And okay, so here in this case, you see that this discontinuity is very small, it's almost imperceptible, but you can play a bit with initial state and you can emphasize this kind of discontinuity. So in general, what does it mean to be discontinuous in this limit? It means that there should be some, the transport is not only ballistic, but there should be maybe some diffusive contribution or super diffusive. But we have not yet investigated this this aspect, so I don't know in this case what kind of scaling is describing these particular points. What I want to emphasize is that generally these results are independent of how you prepare the initial state, how you join the initial state. So they are independent of the details in the of the junctions. And this is, I would say, kind of general, because when you perturb locally a state and then you wait a long time, generally, at least personally, I expect that this perturbation fades away. Okay, so I won't be able to see it late in time. In fact, in this model, you can see you have a counterexample to this general belief. And in order to see the counterexample, I want to briefly introduce a big sector of the model, which consists of gem state. With the gem state, that means that there are particles that are stuck together and they can't move. You can realize here, you can move anything.
Okay? Mauricio, 2 minutes,
Mauricio. Okay, fine, I will be very quick. So if you consider this sector of gem state, which if you want should satisfy this condition, this model, okay, it's not important. Then, if you now imagine to perform a local measure on the state, for example, this is a gem state I'm preparing here, and I consider local measurement on a spin up, okay? And I'm imagining that there is a blind measurement, so I don't know the unknown, the outcome of the measurement. So in the end, the state will collapse to what well, collapse okay, to a density matrix, and the spin will be either down or up in that position. The up part is just the same initial state, the same state as before, is a gem, nothing happens. But instead, this is a non-trivial time evolution. So what happens if I study the evolution? Well, what happens is that okay. What happens is that I find that the expectation value of the observable are non-trivial on macroscopic scales. So on a, if you plot the expectation value as a function of the distance from the measure over the time, then you still find a non-trivial profile, despite the measurement being local, or the local part of the system. Okay, so well, since it's late, I stop here. So I just presented a particular a strong coupling limit of an integrable system, and well, you see, describe a bit of peculiar feature that can arise in this limit. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Maurizio. So now it's time for questions. Does anybody have any? John, go ahead.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, thanks for the nice talk. So you mentioned towards the end this result that you have for the energy currents where you say that it's ballistic with some sort of discontinuity. But I mean, if I remember correctly, and I've done a little bit of work on this from the open systems perspective, I mean, the results by Marco Sniderich on boundary driving in the kind of delta greater than one limit for the spin transport is interesting because the spin transport is diffusive, right? With yes. The diffusion coefficient, which goes like one over delta. Is this consistent with the theory? I mean,
okay. What happens here? Okay. Thanks for the question. Because indeed, what I want to stress is that the properties of this model, the strong coupling limit, is very different from the properties of XXE. In particular, okay, for the article one, did you have a very strange behavior? It's not even diffuse.
Yeah.
But for delta large one should be, you see discontinuity of the spin. Here, instead, what you see is that in this case, you have discontinuities that are completely independent of the spin. It's a completely new, because it's related to a different symmetry that emerges in the limit. So they are very different. They are not related.
Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Okay, any other comment or question? Yeah, Marcos, please.
Okay, so yeah, maybe I can ask a question here about the time scales. I mean, this is very interesting, right? That when you take the translational invariant model, right, and you make the field very strong, you have inhomogeneity survive, right? It's kind of smells like MBL, I would say. So the question that I wanted to ask is about the time scale. So, I mean, essentially, can you prove that so long as you have hoping, you will equilibrate and then there is some very long time scale?
Okay, so we are talking about XXZ now. We are in
XXZ. That's right. The XXZ,
that's correct. That's correct. Indeed, I can answer you without doubt if for a particular initial state, which I consider it was a dimerized the Majumdar-Ghosh state, because in that case, indeed, you have this kind of the picture that I showed you at the beginning. You have you look like that the symmetry is not restored, but then if you wait, in fact, you can see that it's restored. And the time scale is order, if I'm wrong, is 1 over delta. Sorry, it's delta, but not 1 over delta. So you have the time scale in which you have this kind of breaking of the symmetry is order of 1 hour or 2, delta over j, let's say. Oh, no, okay. The dimension are wrong, but okay, it's delta.
Okay.
And but after that, it should relax. I mean, it relaxes really. You can see, and a simple way to do that is to decrease that, if you want, because when delta is very large, it's kind of difficult to see because okay, the limitation of the numerical simulation. But if you decrease it, it becomes clear.
I see. So there is no threshold. You can prove there is no threshold for relaxation.
I don't think that there is a threshold. Now I can't. Okay, that's a big. I can't prove that, but I don't think that there is a threshold.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, so let's thank Maurizio for your talk.